Hello again, and we will now start a discussion of how to construct muffin tin potentials. So, like I said, the muffin tin potentials are actually having 1 by r dependence, or rather muffin tin potentials are spherically symmetric, not 1 by r dependent, muffin tin potentials are spherically symmetric. Within the atom, within the atomic region, and constant between in the interstices between atomic regions. Let's see how we can construct that. So, to construct that, first of all, what we really do is the following. That is, we take the unit cell and draw spheres which are touching each other. They should not, one sphere should not go into another sphere, which are touching each other. Each other around every atom in the unit cell. Actually, the sphere radius in principle can be determined when the two spheres touch each other, then if the potential is the same, then that will be the sphere radius. For example, you know, like if I have two spheres with potentials V of R1 around one sphere and V of R2 around other sphere, then if the two spheres are, this is the sphere around center 1 and this is the sphere around center 2, then I make sure that they touch each other when V at R1 is equal to V at R2. Sorry, there is no vector notation here. Then R1 is radius of sphere 1 and R2 that of sphere 2. So, this is the way one can actually decide. So, one can decide the radius of the sphere afterwards, but we know the centers of the sphere in every case. Having done that, now let us see that I said that supposing I have got a center 1 and a center 2, okay, and let me write down the coordinates for this one. So, this is x1, this is y1. And this is x2 and this is y2 and this is the internuclear distance, which is A, let me call it. And now I can, if I take any point r, then I can have coordinates of r in both the coordinate systems. So, this one will be R2 and this angle will be theta 2 and this will be R1, this angle will be theta 1 and supposing I draw a plane which contains R like this, then you see that this is phi 2 and this is phi 1. So, the conditions that we have are the following. That is, R1 squared is equal to A squared plus R2 squared minus 2AR2 cos theta 2, and then I have R1 cos theta 1 plus R2 cos theta 2 is equal to A, because that is the projection of R2 onto the z axis and projection of R1 onto the z axis, and the two projections will sum up to A. And then we also have R1 sin theta 1 equal to R1 sin theta 2 is equal to R2 sin theta 2. So these are the relationships between the coordinate systems R1 theta 1 phi 1 and R2 theta 2 phi 2. Phi 1 is equal to phi 2, of course. Now, if I have a function which is centered around R1, let me call it psi of R1 or psi lm of R1, is actually FL of R1 times YLM of the angular part of R1, the angular variables theta 1 and phi 1. We can write down, expand this psi lm R1 around the center 2 in spherical harmonics, because spherical harmonics form a basis. So I can expand it as sigma over L prime M prime, some coefficient which depends upon Lm and L prime M prime, and is also a function of the distance, okay, R. And then we have Y L prime M prime R2. This is what is called Laudin's alpha expansion. Laudin's alpha expansion technique. Although this looks like, you know, you are going to be having a large number of spherical harmonics you have to deal with, both Lm and L prime M prime, that is not true, because it simplifies for two reasons. One, the potential around R1 is around center 1, not R1. Around 1 is spherically symmetric. That means all we need to deal with is only psi 0 0 of R, which will go as psi 0 0 of R will be 1 upon root 4 pi, because that is the normalization constant for y 0 0 times f of R1. Okay. And the second thing that is a saving grace is that we are only interested in the L prime equal to 0, M prime equal to 0 component, because that is the only one that is spherically symmetric as seen from origin 2. Okay, so which means that I am only interested in the following quantity, which is F of A, which is the separation between the two centers, and R2 is as measured from the center 2, what the contribution of the potential is. F of A of R2 is actually alpha 0 0 0 0, and this is equal to 1 upon 4 pi, okay, because you also have a square root of 1 upon 4 pi coming from y is 0 0 corresponding to L prime equal to 0 and M prime equal to 0. So this times F of R1 dr2. And this dr2 is over all the angles. Now, in order to find out what dr2 is, this dr2 is equal to sine theta 2 d theta 2, because integration over phi 2 is already taken care of, which will become 2 pi. So I can actually write this whole thing as f of a r 2 equal to alpha 0 0 0 0 is equal to 1 half of integral f of r 1 sine theta 2 d theta 2. We have this relationship, r 1 squared is equal to r 2 square plus a squared minus 2a r 2 cos theta 2. So I can differentiate r 1 with respect to theta 2, in which case I will get 2 r 1 d r 1 by d theta 2 is equal to r 2 is independent of theta 2 because they are independent variables, a is a constant. So all that I will get here is minus 2 a r 2 minus sin theta 2. So I have r 1 d r 1 is equal to a r 2 sin theta 2 d theta 2. So this is one condition that I will get for the integration variable, or I can say that sin theta 2 d theta 2 is equal to r 1 upon a r 2 d r 1. Now I want to know what the integration limits are, integration limits, because we have to take theta 2 would be the limits of integration are 0 to pi. Okay. So if I want to find out that, let me again go back to the first equation, which was r 1 squared is equal to a squared plus r 2 squared minus 2 a r 2 cos theta 2. So if I did that, then what, if I look at that condition, then what I have is when theta 2 is equal to 0, we have r 1 squared is equal to a minus r 2 squared, or r 1 lower limit is equal to a minus r 2 modulus. And what happens to when theta 2 is equal to pi, then we have r 1 squared is equal to a plus r 2 squared, or r 1 minimum, okay, and r 1 max is equal to a plus r 2. So what it means is that now I will have to do the integration. The integration has to be for alpha 0 0. This is equal to 1 upon 2 a r 2 integral a minus r 2 to a plus r 2 f of r 1 r 1 d r 1. So once you choose the point r 2, you can always find out what the contribution corresponding to the spherical component of the potential at the point r 2 due to the atom 1, and that is given by alpha 0 0. So once having got that, then what we can do is we have the potential at that particular center will be given by V C is equal to minus 2 Z by R 1, where Z is actually the nuclear charge of the atom at R 1 plus the contribution due to charge density repulsions. Okay, so this is U naught is the potential due to the charge density rho of r, the Coulomb potential. So this can be obtained from Poisson's equation if you know the charge density function. And then we will also have the contribution coming from sigma over all the neighbors V0 AI R, R1, if I'm using the notation R1. So this is also U0 of R1. U0 of R1 is obtained from solving the Poisson equation, which is del squared U0 R1 is equal to minus 8 pi rho of R1. So basically, you have a charge density rho of R is equal to sigma over I over occupied states psi A star R psi A R. The factor 2 comes is absorbed here. It should be minus 4 pi R, but I have absorbed the factor 2, which corresponds to occupancy of each function by 2 electrons. The total potential is then given by the Coulombic potential Vc, which is actually the contributions that are here, which is minus 2z by r1 minus u0 r1 plus sigma over I v0 ri plus an exchange correlation function r. So this exchange correlation function is something that was first approximated by Slater. Slater used it as V exchange was going as rho to the power 1/3. So there was a certain constant factor and then times rho to the power 1/3. This was one of the earlier ones. But in the current day, you do a density functional theory, DFT calculations involving Cohn-Sham orbitals. There you use Vxc is replaced is some B3 lip potential or whatever other kind of potential, because after all Cohn-Sham density functional theory calculation is somewhat like empirical Hartree-Fock calculation, because you do not have the functional form for the kinetic energy and you also do not know the exact exchange correlation. So what you do is you assume that you can build up potentials which are exchange correlation functions, which take into account the true correlation, true exchange correlation, plus the error due to using del squared as the functional for the kinetic energy. So it is purely so, and if the results are good, then you accept the potential. And what people have found is that B3 lip potentials are pretty good for most of the calculations. So exchange correlation, you can use it as a B3 lip calculation. Now after having done that, what we really want to do is find the potential in the interstitial regions. So once we get V tot of R, we can fix the radii of the Muffington spheres. And we can also calculate what the average potential is in the interstitial region. So to do that, one does the following approximation. You assume that V average in the interstitial part is actually some kind of average or the difference in the potential Vt of R between spheres of radius R0 cubed and S cubed, where S cubed is the I'll describe as we go along. So this is actually S to R0 Vt of R, R squared dr, because I am averaging over all the angles, R0 cubed minus S cubed. S is the sphere of the radius of the muffin tin sphere. I am assuming only one muffin tin sphere per unit cell, so this is, it can be generalized more than that, is the radius of the muffin tin sphere. And R naught is the cell volume divided by number of atoms, is the cell volume per atom, okay, and that is equal to 4/3 pi R naught cubed. And I have to be careful, so this is, there is no integration variable there, so I will take it out here, because both S and R naught are constants. So once you calculate the average, then we can redefine the potentials in the muffin tin spheres as I just shift it, okay. So V of R, there is no angular dependence, is equal to Vt of R minus V average. Okay, so we have made sure that the average potential actually is 0, so that the reference energy is corresponding to the average potential 0 in the interstices. So you can actually have just simple plane waves, even if it is constant you can have plane waves, but that is the way that is defined. Now in the APW method, we have constructed the potential . Hence the Hamiltonian is defined. Next one, what we want to do is form the basis. So the basis are what are called the augmented plane wave functions. So you augment the plane waves by adding on the core part. So these are augmented plane wave functions or the basis functions. These are the inside a sphere. They are basically psi Lm rho. Rho is the coordinates, I am measuring the origin is centered on the nucleus of the atom, and rho is the distance from the atom. So this is given by Ylm rho, the angular part, times RL of, it should also depend upon energy and then the scalar rho, where the solution is psi Lm rho is the solution of the following equation: 1 by rho squared d by d rho, rho squared d by d rho plus L into L plus 1 by r squared plus V nu of rho, because nu th atom. This times R L epsilon comma rho is equal to epsilon equal prime R L epsilon prime comma rho. So that is a Schrodinger equation that you have to solve for some energy values epsilon prime, to which I will come in there when we deal with the matrix element and so forth. Now chi of rho, which is the APW function inside the sphere, APW function inside the sphere is chi of rho is equal to sigma over L equal to 0 to infinity, sigma over M equal to minus L to plus L, ALM YLM rho RL E comma rho. In practice, although you know L equal to 0 to infinity and M equal to minus L to plus L, in practice one uses we stop at L equal to 3. So when you stop at L equal to 3, you have taken care of the S, the P, the D and the F orbitals, and anything beyond is not necessary. So this is why we just keep L equal to 3. And ALMs are not yet specified. In the outer region, the wave function is a plane wave. In the interstices, the basis function is a plane wave. What we need to do is, so what we are saying is chi k comma rho or r is equal to e to the power I k dot r. So this is actually the origin is referred to the origin of the laboratory frame, not to any particular nuclear center. And it also satisfies the condition chi k comma r plus r l is equal to e to the I k dot r plus r l equal to e to the I k dot r l chi of k comma r So, because you know, e to the I k dot r is chi k of r. So, it follows from here. And what we need to do is match up the two functions at the boundaries. The APW function must be continuous on the surface of the sphere. How we do it, I will discuss in the next lecture, but for now I have just introduced how to construct the Muffington potentials and how to construct the APW function in the two regions, which is in the atomic region and in the interstitial region, but I have not actually matched them up together. So that matching up together is what I will do in the next lecture, and also set up the Hamiltonian matrix within the APW scheme and show you how one does an APW calculation in general. And from there we will talk about, you know, some of the advantages of this APW method. Of course, this is very widely used in the present day. And then I will also touch upon another method of doing the energy band calculations, again using APW, this thing, the Muffington potentials, and this is the Green's function method. So we will meet again in the next lecture. Thank you very much.